sun is setting. It's currently trolling Kobe and I at the moment. It's very romantic setting.
Now we've got the actual excuse. The sun is literally in my eyes.
Well, let's talk about bans. We do once again see Twitch, Zed, and Elise being banned off of Copenhagen Wolves. That's 3 for 3 as far as all of those champions are concerned. Over on the TCM side, it's a mirror of the previous bans. Listen, Twisted Fate and Castleman.
So still, they have not decided to take away the Karthus. Felt like that was actually a pretty big part of the team comp there last game, and it's going to be available again. So Copenhagen Wolves, early first picking on this Thresh, means that the exact same strategy is open.
It was also a mirror to the previous game in terms of the actual picks and bans. It was first pick for Bonnie D in the previous game, and in this particular one, it's now Unlimited that has denied that champion away. And Thresh has won 2 out of 2 games in this series. That's a knowledge bomb right there.
But the Karthus plus Shyvana combo worked out very well for them late game, so they have just gotten a lot of that control of the battlefield that we were talking about. It depends a lot on the positioning there from the Belgian Beast, though.
So my questioning now from the TCM side, part of what was very effective in the previous comp was that the Cocoon and the Death Sentence from Thresh and Elise was chained with additional CC. Who do they pick to replace both of those champions?
You're right, they have nothing left right now. So it's going to have to come from the top lane and from the duo lane again. There's a lot of options in the duo lane. You can run an AD carry with control, like they did last time with Ashe, or Varus. Both of those are very good picks. And then Sona is pretty similar too. You can have the Flash Crescendos there. That's one option to lock people up. Zyra is also still available, a little bit more defensive of a support, but both of those are very good area of effect control.
Yeah, the Varus-Zyra combo was run by TCM in the very first game. It didn't work out quite as effectively, but that was thanks to Young Buck and Shook getting a very good first blood. You know, yeah. It was more attributed to Copenhagen Wolves making the right plays than it was to the combo not necessarily being as effective. It doesn't look like TCM feels the same for the time.
We'll
wait for it to get locked in, but I do want to mention Kowtaz Ari. It's actually what he played in the LCS when he did substitute for Bjergsen in those first 3 weeks of the spring split. And I particularly like his laning phase as Ari, but I do feel that late game, he's not able to replicate the same sort of kills and picks that we see from Pekka and Alex and some of the other Ari players that have played it over the course of the last year.
Well, we'll see if he can step up in the late game, because Ari is actually a much better counter to Karthus than Lissandra is, and I feel like he's going to have a much better go. The whole team actually is going to benefit a lot more for this. Ari has constant kill potential on Karthus, even just by herself. She doesn't even need the Evelynn ganks, which, by the way, I was talking about, that was the big thing about the Tenerife games, was that Copenhagen Wolves went to that elite Eve jungle every single game. And it's for that early pressure and for the constant ganks that also force TCM to buy pink wards and spend a lot more of their money there.
So one of the things that I find quite interesting about Reckless's champion choice during the course of the series, he's gone Vayne twice against very scary compositions to a Vayne. And in this particular matchup, he's now decided to go for the Caitlyn. Playing a little safer, using that range, why in game 3 are you switching to that longer range champion as opposed to previously when we've seen such scary all-in comps?
Well, they're going to have a lot of early game pressure this time around with the jungle Evelynn constant threat and then roaming Ahri as well. You said that Kowtaz Ahri might not be as effective as someone like Pekka, but I assume that he's still going to be roaming around in the mid game at least and looking for those kills.
The one thing that I distinctly remember from Kowtaz Ahri is once you get to the 5v5s, waiting and seeing where he spirit rushes always left me a little wanting. That was the one thing that stands out for me. To be very fair, I am judging his performances from February of this year. So this is a long time ago that I'm thinking about this, and we'll see how it works out. I do want to highlight one thing that just happened. Kha'Zix has been banned in both of the previous games,
yep.
Was not banned this game in favor of Elise, and JWoww is going to get his insect back.
So there's similar champion roles there with Elise and Kha'Zix. Since he builds Elise so offensively, diving in to finish off champions, it's exactly what he's going to try and do on Kha'Zix. That was also a big champion in the Tenerife games, but this is 3.10 Kha'Zix, So you don't automatically upgrade the Void Spikes and get tremendous wave glare and damage all at the same time.
So one of the things we have been seeing from some of the Kha'Zixes that we've seen in the competitive play, they tend to evolve their Q first nowadays and spam them up. Talk to me about what sort of impact that could have if he's able to actually catch anyone from Copenhagen Wolves alone.
So the Q evolution is the execute bonus to that damage. So not only is he going to get extra damage from isolation, but the lower you are, it's going to help him finish you off so he gets the resets on his jumps. The thing that Copenhagen Wolves have done this time, though, is they've brought that third threat. The jungler is now going to be another threat in Evelynn. So they're going to have much more to worry about than just Reckless and Kowtard.
Well, we'll see what sort of an impact Shook is going to be able to have on this particular matchup, because in Tenerife, it was immense. In Tenerife, it was a lot of focus, a lot of pressure. And in terms of the ganking patterns, outside of the LCS, we do tend to see junglers focusing fairly frequently in the duo lane. Uh-huh. In the LCS, less so. If you have a straight up 2v2 matchup, it takes a long time before we're able to actually do something like that.
Well, especially since the support is going to be the likely one carrying pink wards, it's easy to ward behind you, which is what you need to do against Evelynn. And they're one of the few lanes that will have a lot of opportunity to see the Evelynn ganks coming. However, that being said, there's three different ways she can get into those bushes. If she comes through the lane and you haven't pink warded side bushes, it can be just as devastating.
Well, we'll see how this works out. To everybody that's just joined us all the way over from Stream B, I'd like to welcome you guys to the third match between the Copenhagen Wolves and TCM Gaming. This is the decider game to determine who will face off against KMT in the grand finals on Thursday. KMT did go 2-0 in their semi-final match. Copenhagen Wolves were able to pick up game one of the series. TCM replied in game two. And now we're at our first deciding match here at Gamescom in Cologne, Germany. TCM with some aggressive posturing right now.
And I like how we've sort of evolved over the three games of this series. And now we're seeing the more comfortable picks that we expected at the beginning from these two teams. JWoww going right back to that Kha'Zixx, while Shook very much at home on Evelynn.
Well, we'll have to see if JWoww is able to replicate the performance he had with Elise, because if he can, the resets, the hops, the skips, and the jumps that can come out of Kha'Zixx are significantly more impactful in larger scale team fights. And it is all key on getting that first reset down, and of course being high enough level for you to have the resets.
You definitely want to get two evolutions usually to be able to get the jump evolved. Some people can rush the resets first, but that means that you're going to be missing out on the extra execute damage, and it really does mean your trades are a lot weaker.
Well, in terms of the compositions, we do see that TCM have got a good mixture of long-range initiation, execution, global pressure. They've really got a little bit of everything, but not an extensive amount of anything in particular. I feel like the Copenhagen Wolves just have slightly more effective crowd control with that Zac, the Eve ulti, and the Thresh as well.
Yeah, and it's going to be Evelynn trying to flank around from the side, and Ahri doing pretty much the same thing. So Copenhagen Wolves are going to be a fairly spread out team, and it will be hard for the Belgian Beast to be as effective as before, getting himself into a position that will zone Copenhagen Wolves, because their damage dealing sources can spread out very easily. Evelynn does not have to be anywhere near Caitlyn.
And of course, don't forget that Evelynn can just shake off that slow of the wall of pain thanks to her Dark Frenzy. The one thing I do want to talk about in the first sort of 3 minutes of the game, we've not seen an evade or a buff steal from the Copenhagen Wolves. They appear to be giving Naruto'dor some more breathing room and a little bit more, I don't want to use the word respect, but they're not necessarily as concentrated on taking his buffs in this early game.
They're pretty much just resigned to letting him farm out for the early game. He has not had a huge presence in the lane, and they're looking to get their advantage there, especially with Evelynn going to be able to come in invisible. A nice adaptation that TCM have done to deal with this Evelynn is pink ward the bush into the red side jungler, so at least now they know which side of the map the Evelynn is on. And they, Karthus can be wary of the bottom side of his river, and then JWoww can also be on alert that she's could be down there at any time ganking him and save his leap to get away.
Well, it's definitely something we haven't seen too much of as far as Countess Eve is concerned. There is only one more pink ward in Barney D's back pocket, but he is miles and miles away from lane and the stress at this point in time, and thanks to the pressure that Reckless and Unlimited were putting down on them, the lane was pretty extended. This is also the first 2v2 and 1v1 matchup from the get-go that we've seen from these teams, as they both put themselves in sort of 1v2s in the previous games.
And it's a both of them switching their lanes top, which usually is a sign that the pink side team or the red side team, depending on how colorblind you are, have decided that they want the 2v2 and the 1v1 situation. But that is a remnant of the past where the golems were taken early, and now the switch there is mostly because of the dragon presence. Without a kill down bottom, it doesn't seem like there's going to be a threat of an early dragon in this game. So this might even be one of the slower early games that we'll see today.
Well, there's a lot more on the line for this as well. Narutiador is going to come in. Kaltar does have a charm available. Then it's just to land that onto Shyvana. He doesn't burn the flash. Thinking through the potions, that's no potions there. But landing the skill shot needed and preventing any of the damage that Narutiador could have put down.
Yeah, Ahri 100% skill shot based champion. That's why Karthus has started with boots. Belgian Beast looking to dodge and mitigate those. However, Narutiador ran right into that one, so he was not able to get anything off besides a little bit of harass.
Well, Zac versus Karzix, it's champions that we're very familiar with, but a matchup that we don't see all too often. Both champions have got sort of close range, sustained type of abilities, but you gotta feel that Young Buck is in a stronger position as his don't cost mana.
Now, we do have Evelynn creeping up from the mid lane to get in behind this duo, and Shook has got to assume that there's no pink ward here because they didn't back up yet, and he saw Nami place this pink ward. So even though there is vision in the river, he knows about it, and he can actually make use of that. Playing the jungle, a huge part of it is not only knowing what cooldowns have been used and what's available to your enemies, but also what information you fed to them.
Well, we do see that the pink ward was instantly put down from Unlimited, clearing out his opponents. And you know, if Shook 2 decides to repeat the same path and go through that tri-bush again, there's no pink there. He'll be able to come in cleanly and safely. However, once again, another cheeky adaptation of dealing with Eve. We see that the Belgian Beast has stuck himself a little pink ward just north of the river entrance. So if that repeat performance, if that route around the side takes place, Evelynn is going to get spotted out. I really like TCM's very strategic and well thought out positioning as far as the pink wards are concerned.
It's the same idea of middle and top warding both of the respective entrances to the river. It's just the only adaptation here is that they're using pinks instead of greens because the jungler is Evelynn.
Well, for the time being, Opening of Wolves and TCM still trying to find a way into this match. Shook 2 does have his Agony's Embrace, doesn't manage to land, nor does the charm. Belgian Beast with those boots is just shuffling his way around everything. Does burn flash, but gets away unscathed.
That gank 100% relies on the slow being landed by Evelynn so that Ahri can follow up with her skill shots. Booted up, Karthus just has too much speed for Ahri to be able to land that one without the slow being applied.
So, Belgian Beast doing well in this lane for the time being. 51 CS to the 53. That's bang on even. The numbers across the board are actually very close. And the one thing you have to give props to Shook 2 in this game for, his farming is now on par with Narutiador. And Narutiador is actually falling a little bit off the pace what we've seen in two previous games.
Evelynn is actually, deceptively, one of the best jungle clearers in the game, because a lot of people will run attack damage reds and ability power on Quints and maybe even blues there. So with the attack speed bonus from her E and the spam of the Q, she can clear extremely quickly, especially when she has blue buff.
Oh, Wall of Pain goes down. Flash is available for Kaltar. Spirit Rush is not. Is forced to pop that flash. So successful ganks in the mid lane. Both solo laners now without that flash available. One thing that we do have to highlight that we haven't mentioned just yet, Kaltar does have summoner teleport, and we'll have to see how effectively he can make use of that.
Without the flash though, and without the spirit rush, it's going to be a while before he does use it. These repeat ganks here by Narutiador middle have slightly paid off just in relieved pressure on the rest of the map.
And I guess, you know, you touched on the fact that Ahri is a pretty good counter to Karthus. So all that additional love and attention that Narutrador is placing in the mid lane just makes Kaltod second guess. Do I want to dive in? Do I really want to throw everything I have at a kill? Because where is that sneaky Shyvana? How close is Narutrador to really making my life a misery?
Exactly. He's been saving his charm to deal with the gank. So he hasn't gone offensive and he hasn't made the Belgian Beast pay in this matchup, which he normally should be.
Well, for the time being, all the lanes continue their farming, continue CSing as best as possible. In the early game, presence that Caitlyn offers in lane is really paying dividends. You can see that Reckless has got himself 84 CS to the 58 to Matroka. That's nearly a 30 advantage, which before 10 minutes in the clock is a very good number to have at this level of the game.
Now, the pink ward down at Dragon means that they're confident there's no vision inside of it, but the pink ward up by the river saw them lead in towards the dragon. So TCM are able to fire an arrow, a warning shot at least.
And that was really good communication from the Copenhagen Wolves. They knew the arrow was coming down and it had obviously been called by Reckless and Unlimited. And instantly, the three members of the Wolves that were on the dragon peeled off, rolled away, basically prevented any negative. Unlimited takes a couple extra tower shots. He wasn't really looking forward to those.
Now that top lane, talking about the early presence of Caitlyn. Oh, here we go again mid.
This charm lands, however, Orbit Deception goes out. Spirit Rush backwards. There's absolutely no damage onto either of these champions, but the Requiem goes down. Shulk is able to walk away, and yeah, that hurt, but a little bit early. The charm pulls the Rutsudor backwards. He's forced to flash away. Copenhagen Wolves pick up a clean 1-0.
Yeah, huge win for Copenhagen Wolves right there. This time the slow does land, allowing for the charm to hit. Some good aggression.
Very nice play. Pulls Matroko backwards and Reckless is just tearing through them. Barney D down to about 180, 200 HP. Matroko forced to 300 himself and they just continue trading. Young Buck is on that bottom lane. He was hit by Requiem, but it doesn't even look like he was.
Now, the top lane up here, you were talking about the Caitlyn presence in lane. I wanted to shout out the supports because this support matchup is a classic one. Very, very highly valued supports, and it's because of the crowd control that they do offer. However, it's skill-based for both of the champions, so a lot of the lane pressure that you get is when either the Nami can land the Aqua Prison or Thresh's Death Sentence. And we've just had Unlimited been a little bit higher percentage hit rate on the Death Sentences than Barney D on the Aqua Prisons.
And it's obviously paying off in CS numbers for their respective AD carries. I mean, Matroko.
Oh, the arrow!
Goes up. They've caught Reckless. He gets knocked up into the air by the wave, thrown up in the air by the prison. Exhaust goes down. This is going to be a kill for TCM Gaming. And it's something we always talk about. It's like a respect recall. You should never be doing that one. Dragon is also secured by TCM, so they lose a tower, but they get a kill and a dragon.
Well, that's just lane wards paying off there. If you ever have a problem with your support not wanting to waste money, quote-unquote, on wards within the lane to get bush control, you can point them to those kills.
Show them that clip. That is exactly what you need to be highlighting. In terms of the first backs, we do see that Young Buck is working towards that Sunfire Cape, whereas TCM, JWoww rather, he's managed to secure himself that Hex Drinker, and I guess against Azak and Eve and Ahri, I think that's a good pickup.
And something about that dragon that they just picked up too, you have to shout out the pink wards that they placed because of the Evelynn. Sort of got a side bonus there of continually clearing out Copenhagen Wolves' vision of the dragon, so they really had no idea. And that allowed TCM to get both of those objectives at the same time.
You also could argue that those objectives are more important for TCM to secure because of the added expense of buying those pink wards. So if they do start to fall behind towers and dragons, well, they're two towers down, you can see the gold deficit is already like 1,200 actual difference before you start factoring 5, 6, 7, 8 times 75 gold difference for those pink wards.
Yeah, the Vision War, like many other wars, extremely expensive and you need dragon funds to be able to keep up.
Well, we'll see if TCM can maintain control of that dragon. Shook 2, with that Agony's Embrace available, is now moved to the bottom lane where we see both teams' duo laners ready to battle it out. The arrow is available for Matroko. Bonnie D is shortly going to get that tidal wave up. We haven't had much time to actually look at this top lane. Young Buck, he's only 9 CS behind, but we have seen him forced fairly low multiple times.
This is actually really good for JWoww. He's kept up very well in CS and is almost at that level 11
And we do see the Let's Bounce coming up. Young Buck is going to get South Division packed. We do see Kaltar jumping in. Now the passive is down for Zach, so at the very least, if Huruchador wants to continue fighting or set that one up again, they may be able to actually pick up a kill.
That's another dangerous recall spot for JWoww, but because there's no vision in that, Kaltar's not going to check in and he'll be fine.
Oh, the bubble throws Reckless up in the air. Piltover Peacemaker goes down. Ace in the Hole is available. The Barney D should be able to body block. Auto attacks going down for Reckless as we do see that Unlimited continues throwing out those chains auto attacks.
Now, Reckless wants to stay around because he has Ace in the Hole and he wants to be able to finish someone off. But on the other side, there's a Karthus, so he has to be worried about his own health because that Requiem could come in and finish him off.
Well, we'll see how efficiently Reckless can farm up that HP. He does have that Bloodthirster, so lifesteal is going to be very, very high on these last couple of minions. Plus 50 per auto attack, plus 120 on the
headshot. I think
he's fine.
Those
right
are
now.
Juicy.
Definitely helps as far as the sustain is concerned. Over on the other side, Matroko with his Ash, he's picked up that pickaxe early again, and he's gone for the Vamp Scepter, so falling a little behind as far as damage is concerned.
And we also have seen some good communication, though, by Copenhagen Wolves. They called Eve back because there's a pink ward in this side bush, but called down Ahri.
And here comes Ahri's Spur Rush goes in. Matroko's charmed up. Kaltar is exhausted, so most of his damage does get reduced, but a perfectly executed 3v1 tower dive results in next to no health being lost across the board. All four members of Copenhagen Wolves now turn their focus to the tower, the last outer tower for TCM.
So, Kaltar's mid-game roaming Ahri, check. In fact, he does make use of it. Great job there. And that's what you lose when you lose an inner turret, especially against a roaming assassin like Ahri. You're going to pay for it in the side lanes.
And you have to talk about how accurate Kaltar's charms have been. He's managed to land so many. Typical. The second I say it, But to be fair, that wasn't a very crucial one. That was just for damage.
Well, that's going to ruin his percentage, Quickshot.
Yeah, I know. I won't say anymore because it's cast a curse. We do see JWoww level 11 now, got two evolutions. He has done, he's leveled up that Taste of Fear as well as his Leap, as we talked about. So nothing too surprising, but he's still working himself to a power position. I mean, he's only got a Hex Shrinker, a couple of long swords. There's no armor penetration built for that giant bug just yet.
It's very interesting that he has not gone with the Man Immune build. And he's actually built for lane, going with that Hexstringer to get the early magic resist. Because of the lack of mana regen that he has from not going that build, he started with that Flask. So definitely some forethought there, and I like the adaptation here. Definitely an experienced Kha'Zix player.
We'll have to see if it works out in any prolonged engagements. You know, if Copenhagen Wolves do manage to split and spread and require TCM to chase them down, he may actually run out of mana during those engagements. But for the time being, TCM, simply no towers on the board, and Huruchador is immune to Kaltar's charms.
It's pretty interesting that Copenhagen Wolves are going to want to split and spread, as you put it, because of the Karthus, so they can avoid the area of effect damage. But in doing that, it makes them vulnerable to JWoww's assassination attempts. And with that leveled up Q, he does get the 45% isolation anyway. He's also going to be having the execution damage.
I wish the best of luck to our cameraman when the fight break out, because there is so much mobility on so many of these champions that they are going to be flying all over the screen.
It's really going to be watching the Crystal Arrow, because when Copenhagen Wolves spread out for the Karthus, if the Crystal Arrow from Matroko lands on any of those three targets, the Evelynn, the Ahri, or the Caitlyn, then the TCM will easily be able to capitalize on that and jump for it.
Well, that's where your eyes need to be focusing, ladies and gentlemen. This is once again the deciding game in the Challenger Series Promotion Tournament Qualifier semi-final. The winner gets to take on KMT. We do see that Kaltar once again throwing the charms. I think I've messed it up. I talked about his charms and I've cursed him. I've ruined his ability to land that skill shot.
That's really bad, because that's what Copenhagen Wolves are looking for. They want picks in this matchup. They are trying to catch members of TCM off guard.
Well, we'll see if they do manage
They've
to
got
land
the
it. The charm does manage to land. It actually pulls Huruchador onto the trap. Now the land, the Ash Arrow does catch out Unlimited, but it's not really who they want. A very good box locks up the entry into the side for Copenhagen Wolves. They manage to pick up two as the Requiem comes down. Not going to be able to pick up any kills as JWoww has not got the recess. Ace in the Hole gets channeled. That goes up the back.
Oh, he got it!
JWoww does manage to get a kill. He manages to escape escape with his life. They end up trading 3 for 2, and the dragon is still standing.
Very, very nice play from JWoww there. Able to get the gold back in their favor, but because of the HP that Zach survived with, they can actually tank out the dragon after this. That charm onto Cupcake. Cupcakes are usually something to go after there, but also the Kiss from Mari, just too tempting, and he's able to jump right on that one. Thresh was hit with the arrow, but still able to get his box, so it was a decent fight for Copenhagen Wolves, but again, very good positioning from the Belgian Beast, able to get inside and land so much damage with his passive up, also getting off the Requiem, enabling TCM to clean up.
Well, you do see that gold is sitting about 2,000 gold away, and considering that TCM are 3 towers down, that's not too bad of a situation. If at any point they do get themselves in a position to actually start taking any of these outer towers, that gold will easily swing back in their favor. But, you know, you have to think that Copenhagen Wolves, they haven't had to fend off many aggressive pushes at all. Outside of that previous little fight that TCM basically got pulled into, they haven't made very many moves.
TCM are waiting for the late game. They were waiting for that level 11 on Kha'Zix at first, and then they're waiting for the Karthus to ramp up. Karthus, by the way, his Rod of Ages and his Tear are both finished, so he's continually scaling up in power. They're okay with waiting until the late game, because Ash is not, you know, a traditional hyper carry, but her power in the late game comes from her ability to engage and catch members of Copenhagen Wolves out. So they're fine with just farming it up as long as they can delay this Copenhagen Wolves teams and not get picked off, then they should be okay. But again, looking at the gold difference, you have to also take into account that Pink Ward tax, which has been weighing heavy on TCM.
Yeah, we do see that JWoww is currently sitting 2-0. He's got that Last Whisper and that Brutalizer completed, so that is a metric ton of armor penetration that's, you know, gonna go through. There isn't too much armor stacked up across the majority of the Copenhagen Wolves, but it's something that is gonna be very scary to deal with right now. Ash Arrow is available if they want to use it. However, Ash is miles and miles away as the rest of the Copenhagen Wolves are stacking sort of towards this top lane.
Ooh, Ahri does get the charm off, but so much damage already taken from Shyvana.
Naruto Adore is just going to be able to zone Kaltod out completely, and Kaltod forced to use that Spirit Rush completely defensively. He realized that he'd bitten off a little more than he could chew.
He saw the Kha'Zix coming in for the isolation, and he wanted to get miles away from JWoww, but he couldn't get far enough.
So a top lane kill does manage to land. JWoww able to tower dive that one. You can see the tails of Ahri spawning from the bottom of the tower. Belgian Beast does get locked up completely. The 3 members of the Copenhagen Wolves able to just invade this one. Requiem comes down, Unlimited does survive. Ash Arrow comes up. Is it gonna catch? Flies way wide. Now JWoww, if he can find anybody, that's very low health targets, and he'll be able to just fly through the air to secure them. They've got Bonnie D. He manages to just get dropped instantly, and now Shook is way overextended. Ace in the Hole goes out. One more hate spike secures the kill.
One.
And that is a dead Evelynn as JWoww just pops him and jumps away.
And that was 4-on-5. Ash has been split pushing this bottom lane the entire time. She's about to get it to the turret wave, but Ahri's here to answer. Spirit Rush will be up in 5 seconds. So if Ash sticks around, then she would be able to pounce on her. Good recall here.
Copenhagen Wolves are gonna be able to recall. That was running very close. You know, Ash at this moment in time, 40 creeps behind, no items completed until this very second IE. But that is a fairly late Infinity Edge when you consider their opponent has got basically a fully stacked Bloodthirster and a Lost Whisper.
It's not too bad, as Evelynn's the only one building real armor here, so at least she can land the crits. And aided by Ash's passive, the first shot there is going to do plenty of damage. So at least she has gotten the most important item in Ash's arsenal.
Well, definitely going to be working towards some additional attack speed. When Matroko has played Ash in previous games, Phantom Dancer was the next point of call for him. It is a natural progression, and thanks to the tower that was being secured in the bottom lane and some kills, considering that now JWoww is 4-0, that gold value is still actually decreasing. It's now below 2,000 total, and you know, it's definitely a position that TCM are going to be fairly happy about. I think they're fairly comfortable the longer this game goes based on their composition.
They are indeed, for all the reasons we just went over. The Karthus ramping up is about to take effect too. He just spent a bunch of money on his boot upgrades, so he hasn't actually turned that tier into an Archangel Staff yet. but he will get a nice boost when he does as well, because there's a punch of mana on that Rod of Ages as well.
Yeah, and in terms of the home guard boots at this stage in the game already, when you consider the TCM of four towers down and their mid lane, they're already at the inhibitor turret, they cannot afford to get pushed that far back. And you know, Belgian Beast's positioning in and around the inhibitor stairs in previous game was really, really good. He finds ways to die in optimal positions.
And I think they're happy with JWoww being the one in control of most of the kills here. Last game it was Elise. He's performing basically the same role here, and he's going to have to do the same thing he did last time and actually avoid the engage here from Copenhagen Wolves. As long as he doesn't get charmed, they're going to have a very, very scary threat from the side.
Yeah, and in every single game in this series...
Oh, he goes for Ahri.
...has drawn two target bans. Kaltod is alive for a little while. Spirit Rush goes up. Here comes Young Buck. JWoww stealths up. Pink Ward goes down to reveal him. Reckless has joined this party as well, but look at Narujirador. He is closing in. Reckless actually 90 caliber netted towards JWoww. Realize, oh, maybe this isn't the smartest idea, and backs away instantly.
It was a nice attempted bait there from Kaltar, though, trying to draw in JWoww and then dropping the pink ward as he spirit rushed away. They weren't able to lock him down, though, because you get multiple activations of that ultimate on Kha'Zix, and with the extra speed boost, he was able to get his way out.
So that manages to at least avoid that particular setup. TCM continually closing the gap as far as the gold is concerned in this matchup. 25 minutes has just gone past. And we noticed that the Copenhagen Wolves, they actually started warding up in and around the Baron Pit as they've started the dragon right now.
They have a pink ward that sees JWoww's movements, so they know they have time to get away from this dragon. And they're still going to be watching for that crystal arrow, though.
I just caught a glimpse there of JWoww at level 16. If I seen correctly,
oh, yeah.
He's leveled up his ultimate as his third, as opposed to those Void Spikes. So very different to what we used to see in the old school Kha'Zixes. And TCM with superior positioning, they secure their second tower of the game. That's the Copenhagen Wolves mid tower gone down.
Yeah, so he's going to get yet another activation on his ultimate and take reduced damage in the team fights. So he doesn't have to completely rely on getting the reset and jumping back out. He can just chain his jumps for extra damage.
And we do see a sing shot comes in from Young Buck, forces the flash from Flaky D. Flaky's on the mind. He manages to get Barney D to force the flash. And we do see JWoww, he actually manages to just leap over the wall to safety. Right now, it's just a matter of whoever gets caught first. If someone eats an Ash Arrow, they're going to die. And if someone eats a Charm or a Death Sentence, they're going to die.
They both do have very, very strong tools for picking people off here. The Evelynn plus Ahri has not had a huge impact lately, so this is actually the wrong target to go for. If they pick off Narujirador, it's not going to accomplish that much. Meanwhile, if your split pusher is Kha'Zix, having already upgraded his leap and his ultimate, he's as slippery as a Kha'Zix can be. So he can pretty much shove that lane with pure confidence that when someone collapses on him, he'll be able to escape using both the leap and the ultimate charges.
More importantly, I don't feel like there's anybody on the Copenhagen Wolves squad that can deal with his split pushing. You can see that Reckless and Unlimited, they're trying to come up and maybe challenge that top lane, but JWoww should be able to 1v1 anyone.
It's going to have to be multiple people. There's a pink ward still here, though, so they could turn this one around.
Wow, Shux actually throws down the Agony's Embrace instantly, and JWoww just leaps away. So cooldown blown. It's not the end of the world that Agony's Embrace isn't the longest of cooldowns, but very defensive reaction from Shook too.
It was a really good move there by JWoww, realizing that there was nothing else to be gained and just taking that small win, jumping out.
Yep, he gets away cleanly, 235 CS, second highest total in the game, behind Reckless, who is 278 at the 27-minute mark. A Caitlyn that is that well farmed is just getting more and more terrifying. Phantom Dancer, Bloodthirster, and Last Whisper completed. And we do tend to see Reckless picking up a defensive item as a fourth or fifth
game. Good flash.
Manages to flash past the Crystal Arrow, but there's no flash available. Takes a ride in the Dark Passage. It's not over yet as Narujirador now joins the party. The bubble throws Reckless up in the air, and with his damage down, TCM are going to be able to carry on chasing. We do see that there's no Agony's Embrace available for Eve, so he's forced away. And J-Well, Eve to taunt in a death sentence, not sentenced to death right now, until Youngbuck comes in there with the lens bounce. All of a sudden, Copenhagen Wolves turn this fight completely on its head. Requiem starts being channeled, and nobody's really low enough for it to drop them, with the exception there of the Kaltard. It's trading 3-for-3 as far as the team fight goes. We do see Naruto Door now trying to challenge against Unlimited, as Youngbuck's passive has been popped. Shook to Unlimited, trying to pick this one up, but all of a sudden, Unlimited may be in a little bit of trouble. This is a blue and red buff Evelynn that is chasing down Shyvana. As soon as Dark Frenzy becomes available, gonna try and chase the burnout, and you got two very speedy characters running across the map. Shooktu throws down the Dark Frenzy. Hate Spike's gonna be enraged. Agony's Embrace just comes off cooldown. Gonna be forced to back away.
That second guess right there almost cost him, but still able to get away. No follow-up from Evelynn, and they turn their eyes towards Baron. The preemptive sweep by Unlimited, able to clear out the wards. And it's only going to be Nami in position to answer this one.
There is no tidal wave available. Teleport's coming down from Kaltard, with those home guard boots available, and with Reckless's damage on the back here as well.
They have to run right after this. Kha'Zix is coming.
Bubble comes up. Arrow's going to land. Misses. Youngbuck sidesteps the arrow. Manages to land a charm onto Belgian Beast. Kaltard is going to lock up Karthus for long enough to allow Reckless to pick up a kill.
That could not have gone better for Copenhagen Wolves. They even were rewarded with a kill upon leaving Baron Pit right there. Kaltard just earned his stripes as Ahri.
So very well played. Here's a replay of the previous fight. Talk us through this, Kobe.
So that was just a great arrow dodge, but then a bad dark passage to take for Reckless and put him in a compromising position. But it also baited in the whole team into this tiny passage inside the jungle, which opened everything up for Copenhagen Wolves to answer. It was J-Well being overextended and taking tower hits while the rest of his team was leaving through that jungle passage. And because J-Well stuck around, took those tower hits, they had to turn back around, which bought time for Zac to reinitiate. And he does not even mind reinitiating on top of that Karthus ulti because he's so tanky and he had that passive to rely upon.
So I'm managing to work out for the best at the end of the day for Copenhagen Wolves. They still maintain a mere 2,000 gold lead. It is very, very small. This game is by no means over between these two teams. And yeah, you know, as long as Matroka can land an arrow, someone will die.
That's the drawback of all those kills going to J-WoW. He got a little overconfident there. Got out in front of his team, got into tower range, and then got charmed and paid for it.
Something that we actually didn't see as much of in Super Week in the EULCS was exhausts against those assassins. Unlimited throws out the death sentence, doesn't manage to catch anybody, but the Copenhagen Wolves have got positioning to challenge for this blue buff, and they managed to secure that one fairly safely. They just had a shoulder bump TCM away.
I actually really like that support point. A lot of supports have been trending towards those ignites in lane for the kill potential, but exhaust cannot be overrated against a team with an assassin like Kha'Zix. I think it was Krepo in an interview who was shouting out, why are the sports not taking exhaust anymore, especially when you're running against multiple assassin teams? It can mean the difference in an endgame teamfight, which is actually where you're going to get the win, not in those lane phase kills.
Well, for the time being, that's exhaust onto J-WoW secured them a kill previously, and TCM actually have two exhausts on their side. So if they want to deal with Evelynn, Ahri, and potentially Reckless, they can at least deal with two of the three. J-WoW, 275 CS, he's recalling in the top lane. That tower is still standing, considering the exorbitant amount of time that J-WoW spent farming there and pushing the wave. He has not managed to put much damage on that tower at all. TCM's still only two towers to their name. They haven't been able to take advantage of any of the kills or the wins that they've had as far as objectives are concerned.
But neither have Copenhagen Wolves here. It's going to be very hard for Copenhagen Wolves to crack that inside line of inhibitor turrets because TCM always have the crystal arrow in their pocket. And if they're able to land one of those onto the three vulnerable targets of Copenhagen Wolves, then this story could easily be reversed.
Well, we'll have to see how well Matroka can land those arrows, because to be fair, they've been good shots which have been avoided by the Copenhagen Wolves. A good flash from Reckless previously. Youngbuck basically just sidestepped.
That was a beautiful sidestep.
He read that coming pretty well. Managed to get out of range. Maybe the smaller, low HP model size of Zac also helped with the dodgingness. I don't know if the hitbox has changed. An interesting question for the designers.
They do indeed, well, because interesting point here. Most spells from champions are measured from the center of the champion to the center of your target, but skill shots, which are fired as missiles, are the spells that are actually measured to the end of the champion model. So the bigger your model, easier you are to hit. That's why a giant Cho'Gath is amazing to have in a game like this, because they can just block most of the arrows.
And Cho'Gath eats absolutely everything. Even in team fights, you always accidentally click him. So we do see now Unlimited throwing out that Dark Passage, getting some vision down. You see Baron has worn off, so the Copenhagen Wolves are going to start poising themselves maybe to pick up the next one. For the time being, they're just getting vision control in this side of the jungle, and TCM have done a much better job of controlling their half of the map and controlling their jungle camp.
They've swept around towards the middle though, and they can tank this turret, get off some early damage before TCM arrive.
The tidal wave comes down. Young Buck hits a couple of shots for his trouble. Charm goes out, manages to find nothing but air. The box was used as well. So tidal wave in exchange for the box as well as that Enchanted Crystal Hour. Tower defended, and I think that's what TCM really care more about.
Flash down here as well for Young Buck, but he is the target that they would like to sacrifice to hit that crystal, to take that crystal arrow.
And Young Buck, you know, playing Zac, it's not as impactful to have that flash down. You're just going to charge that slingshot up and close a much greater distance. You do see Let's Bounce as well as that Ignite is available. The bubble does manage to catch Young Buck, throws him up in the air. Ooh. He's still sitting at 3,200 HP. It's a very, very tanky Zac.
Now, with the Crystal Arrow and the Nami's Tidal Wave being down, the threat for TCM's engagement is not there. Copenhagen Wolves, you can see, Reckless was taking three or four shots at a time now at the turret because he's not scared of that hard engage. However, they have to keep in mind the timer of this Crystal Arrow. It's very low at this stage of the game. If Copenhagen Wolves pull the same thing, that's going to be available very soon.
Oh, they managed to catch Matroka, but nobody else follows up. However, Copenhagen Wolves have just melted the Belgian Beast. Karthus drops, he throws out the Requiem. The Wolves are on the retreat. Jaywa once again finds himself overextended. He's dived way too deep. Naruto evens the kills up 1-1, but that's a jungler for a mid laner, and JWoww is miles away. He's forced to leap into CW territory and recall to try help defend.
Mirrored positions right there. Shook very deep as an assassin in the TCM team, but not able to get away, whereas JWoww used the second jump.
Ash Arrow comes out, Matroka gets pulled forward. The charm and the net holds him in place. There's no ways Matroka gets away from that one. Copenhagen Wolves secure the inhibitor turret and the inhibitor. 10 seconds left on Belgian Beast, and Matroka will only be up in 45 seconds.
Great presence of mind there by Copenhagen Wolves to take advantage of that window where the cooldowns were up.
Not over yet, as now that JWoww has full health, he actually gets pulled in with a death sentence, looking for cooldowns to jump in. No bubble locking anybody up. JWoww very hesitant to leap in this time. Maybe a little late to start playing patient. Unfortunately, being caught out in the previous fight, it was not ideal at all.
Yeah, Copenhagen Wolves made it count while the Crystal Arrow and Tidal Wave were down, just as it was about to come back up, pulling off that team fight. And with an inhibitor down, they just gained a whole bunch of map pressure.
Well, we'll have to see how Copenhagen Wolves make use of it. The most obvious choice is to make a play for the Baron. Kautard now finds himself between a rock and a hard place. He actually throws out the death sentence. JWoww realizing that he's in a little bit of trouble. He should be able to just leap over the wall. That's a lot of damage from Taste of Fear onto Kautard. Even that armor of the Zhonya's Hourglass, not really going to be enough against that crazy, crazy armor penetration that Kha'Zix has built up.
Yeah, it's an interesting overlap though. They were able to get a little bit of armor, even though there's so much penetration on JWoww, while also gaining the activation of the Zhonya's for the Requiem. So at least their two main members here, the Evelynn and Ahri, can avoid that Requiem damage.
Well, we'll have to see how well Kautard can play. We now hit this sort of near end game build, Deathfire Grasp, Rabadon's Deathcap, as well as that Zhonya's Hourglass. He's got the ability to dive very, very deep, and you know, crucially, when a charm needs to land, he's locking up very key members of the TCM gaming team. Copenhagen Wolves, they've got vision. Not really deep as far as this red buff area of TCM is concerned. Copenhagen Wolves is going to be looking to challenge for Baron.
Yeah, they're going to try and draw TCM out of their base and into a bad spot so that Evelynn and Ahri can make use of their extreme mobility to catch either Matroka or JLoww. Those are the two targets they want to pick off before the fight starts. And they want Evelynn and Ahri to flank around the sides to get an easy shot at those two.
We'll have to see how well Youngbuck can do in helping to set up those particular engagements. Sunfire Cape and Randian is completed. He's only sitting on 190 CS, but to be very fair, Reckless has taken basically all of his solo lane farm once we've hit this mid game. Reckless, 376 CS right now.
He has also upgraded the distortion boots here. So the importance of that flash, because he knows that Evelynn and Ahri are going to be trying to dive in on TCM, he's going to have to take care of himself. And for that, he's going to need both the 90 caliber net and the flash.
And yeah, you talked about how the team fights were going to go for the Copenhagen Wolves, that they wanted to split up, they wanted to spread out, and basically that meant there's no real front line. Zach's going to be throwing himself at TCM, and you know, JWoww is basically the man that's responsible for trying to get to Reckless, but he has been unable to do it up until this point in the game.
Well, he's going to have the flash, the net, and the Thresh Lantern here. As long as Thresh doesn't bait him in like last team fight, and then end the Dark Passage inside the rest of TCM, he should be good. Oh, good bush gank.
So Charm does land. Rutador forced to use that ultimate to escape to safety. Bubble goes up, manages to miss Shook too. Let's bounce. Is all over TCM. Is the ace in the hole. He's going to secure a kill. Another great Charm. Locks up the Belgian Beast, and that's two kills without reply. And that's only 50% of Youngbuck's HP bar that cost them those two kills.
Copenhagen Wolves finally able to catch TCM out split and take advantage of it, all because of the mid inhibitor being down, allowing them to clear out vision around Baron and just drawing TCM over to that very dangerous Baron dance of the end game.
And you know, TCM, once again, they don't have the vision they need on their side of the jungle. The more we watch the TCM roster, the more I realize that once they lose control of the jungle, they don't really know how to get it back, how to reclaim possession of what is technically theirs.
Well, it's a very difficult thing to do when you're up against a team that Copenhagen Wolves are running that's focused on picking people off. Because if you go checking bushes as a support, trying to get wards down, they'll have so many answers to grab you.
Well, the death sentence does land. Rutador actually gets to a lot of damage from Deathfire Grasp and Follow. Now we see Kauta diving forward. Betrocko, the first victim to fall as they take the tower down in the background. Youngbuck does not have less bounce available. Belgian Beast flashes forward. He's between the inhibitor and the walls. He goes down. Going to be able to defend at least some of the inhibitor. Not going to be enough to pick up any kills with that Requiem, unfortunately. Copenhagen Wolves look like they've done it. The two carries of the mid lane and the AD carry for TCM are now down. It's a 3-5 defense. And even though Youngbuck is low, he's got his Cell Division passive available.
That time, the timing of Belgian Beast all in was not synced up with JWoww. He is able to get this kill though.
So JWoww will be able to pick up the kill, at least get a reset on the jump, but he's very, very low. Reckless basically two shots him as he's forced out of the fight, and the Copenhagen Wolves, they managed to pick up the victory. They go 2-1 versus TCM, and you can see the relief on Youngbuck's face. That was a heavy, heavy sigh.
So they get their vengeance that they've been waiting for since Tenerife. Congratulations to the Copenhagen Wolves. Well played pick.
Yeah, very, very good game at the end of the day. They're going to be facing off against the all-Polish roster of KMT in the Grand Finals on Thursday. Remember that TCM, they already have a spot in that spring promotion tournament later in the year. So for the time being, they're not going to be able to get the bragging rights of saying they won the challenger event at Gamescom, but they will be back. They will be facing either KMT or the Copenhagen Wolves once we get to that stage.
And they have that all-important chance to get into the LCS in the promotion tournament.
Yeah, that's the most important thing. And you know, we keep talking about how the bottom three LCS teams, which was SK Gaming,
Meteor Makers,
and whoever's going to lose in the this weekend's playoffs, they will be able to pick which team they feel they have a better chance. And I think it's going to be a difficult choice because TCM and Wolves have both looked phenomenal in all of the events they've taken part in.
Yeah, very, very difficult. Choose your poison, I guess. It depends on which team comp you really want to match yourself up against, because these two teams have very distinct styles. And I guess that's what most of it's going to ride on.
There's going to be another very big question which the Copenhagen Wolves will have to answer as the year goes forward. What do they do with or without Reckless?
That's going to be very difficult because right now their strategy revolves heavily around him, especially when they only run those two threats like we saw in their loss earlier.
Well, I definitely think they'll be learning from the mistakes they've made. Guys, we've got to take a very